Today I want to share some of the techniques that I used for the Middle Beast Soundstorm Festival, where I created this projection mapping on the stage designed by Vision Factory. And I used Cinema 4D for the content creation and then Resolume as the media server. And I just want to share some of the workflows and techniques that I used in both of those programs. So let's jump right into it. What was interesting about this one is that I didn't have the 3D model beforehand. So usually when you have like a projection mapping, you kind of recreate the model or the object or the building in some cases, you know, beforehand. So you create like an actual 3D model of whatever you're projecting on. And then from that, you can create the content. And you also think about how you want to create your mapping. But in this case, there was plenty of time on location. And what I actually did is recreate the model once I got on site and actually saw the stage design. So what I decided to do in this case was first do the Resolume mapping and then create the 3D model based on that. And what I mean by that is if we check the advanced output, here you can see the input map that I had. And basically it was these three sculptures in the middle and then a bunch of shipping containers left and right that were completely white, so it was also a great projection surface. Each of those individual objects is like one piece of these kind of sculptures. So what I decided to do is to map every single one of those as a slice inside of Resolume. And I also decided to stick to rectangular shapes because that's just way easier to work with in Resolume, because you can work with slices in that case and not with polygons. So from this 3D structure that actually in real life, you know, has some depth and also some angles to it, I just used everything as one single plane. I knew that the illusion would still work, but this would just like simplify the workflow by a lot, because Resolume isn't able to do actual 3D mapping and you always have to find some kind of like workarounds to do that. And so in this case, I just used everything as one flat surface, but then still could extrude it in Cinema 4D. So I actually, once I created this map, and I created this just by, you know, looking at the surface, taking like one picture, and then kind of recreating it based on that. So if I check my input, I think somewhere here I still have this. So this was kind of my reference image, which was also kind of the perspective roughly from where I was watching it. Of course, with projection mapping, you always kind of want to integrate or kind of want to think about the sweet spot. So there's always like one perspective from which the whole thing will work best, which is always somewhere in the center where the audience will be. But in this case, because I'm working with like a planar layout, it didn't matter that much. So I just took this picture from front of house view and then worked with these shapes from there. So I just kind of roughly matched all of these shapes. And then here again, I actually had 45 degree angles for the shipping containers, but you can't really account for those in the input mapping in Resolume. You can only do that in the output. So in the input, I used them as squares. And then in the output mapping is where I actually did, you know, the transformation to match them onto the 45 degree angle surfaces. Yeah, so based on that, I created the whole mapping, kind of reverse engineered it, because usually, again, usually you would have the 3D model first, and then based on that and the content that you have, you would fit that onto your projection surface. But in this case, I mapped the surface first, and then once I had all of this input map, I exported it, which you can do here, export as SVG. Then I exported this input map into Cinema 4D, yeah, where I extruded it. So this is what it looked like in Cinema. And in this case, I just have like a planar surface, but even with this, you know, you can still play around with some effectors like this, just having it kind of rotate in and appear and disappear and have some like MoGraph effects. So yeah, even like this would be kind of really effective. And let's have a look at some different variations of of the content that I created. So for this one, for example, I then actually extruded them in the on the Z axis. And so you can see here, this is my shape. And then I also did this Voronoi fracture based off of a plane. So usually with the Voronoi, you would have this kind of point generator, right? Where you can tell it how many points you wanna split it in, and you have this kind of crystallized structure. But you can actually also use a plane as your reference, which is this plane right here. If you import, I'm gonna disable that, if you import your plane into your source, then it will create these fractures based off of the edges of the plane. And so this way you can create this very geometric fractures of the object. And what I added then is a shader, a shader effector, which uses a noise as the shading. And the noise is animated, and so this way when I play this, the whole thing animates. And when I switch back to my render cam, which is the kind of view that I will then export it in to match my input mapping, you can see that when I hit the render button, it looks like this because I also placed the light from the top, which drops some shadows. And so now you can create these interesting kind of shadow effects, splitting the object into multiple objects and then working with some like fake shadows. So this is always some like fun techniques that you can think of. Is you can either work directly with the shapes that are already there. So, you know, using the shapes as they are, if I disable this, like this. And then you can also play around with, you know, the light moving and some kind of shadow illusions like that. But then you can also think of, you know, splitting up the object into several multiple like fractures or instances, and then work with that. Yeah, so from there, the workflow was just kind of thinking of some different techniques that I, you know, tend to use a lot in Cinema 4D. Also figuring out maybe some new ones, and then rendering the content and bring it back into Resolume. So let's have a look at another one that I did, which was this kind of Voronoi organic mesh structure. You can see that there is a light moving in a circular pattern. So you can see that here you have this light going 360 degrees around the object. And you know, with visuals, I always try to like work in loops. So you can just have the content running without any cuts. And so here you can see that from the render view, it will look something like this once the light is up front. And I'll go through these clips later. I just want to kind of show some of the workflows that I used for this. First, I imported all of the cubes into the Voronoi fracture, as we also had it before. So it would look like this. And then I dragged all of that into an atom array, which creates these kind of outline shapes, gave them some thickness. And then you can create this volume generator, which creates like one single volume of all of these objects, which you can then also smooth. So I have the smoothing turned on. And then from this volume, I'm generating a mesh. And that will look like this. So this gives it a very kind of interesting organic structure. And I also like that it doesn't really repeat the pattern, but you know, every single cube of those kind of looks differently. This was also a very effective one where I just took all of the planes and did like a bevel extrude to create these kind of bevel edges. And then again, also added a light to create some fake shadows. And just projecting this as a still onto the whole thing and to use it as a sort of like overlay or mask was like a super neat effect, because you can create like actually some different kind of stage looks just through these fake shadows. Yeah, as I said, this was a super effective one as well. Then I did another one with the atom array turned on, and then again another one where I played around with this meshing again with some smoothing, so you can just create some interesting looks just by that. But this was probably one of the, like, the most effective ones, which really look cool and just transform the whole space again. I could do like a separate, more in-depth video on some of these techniques, but this should just be like a general overview. So if you want me to go into some of these techniques specifically, let me know in the comments and I can do like a specific video on that. And so what these clips then look like in here is like this. So here you can see some of these different renderings. And I just created like a bunch of those just to, you know, experiment. And oftentimes with these mappings, it's like you can't really think like what won't work beforehand. So you really just gotta play around and try some stuff out. You know, after a while you will get some experience and you will know what works and what's effective. But when you're starting out with this kind of mapping, it's really like a super interesting process just to experiment and play with some different techniques and see what works. This was another effective one, just using a noise effector and transforming the rotation. And this is the one that I showed before. Just some kind of still layouts that just change the whole kind of scenery. So, you know, you don't always have to work with like some super dynamic and fast-paced content. It can also be some still images or masks that you just use as overlays. This was a great one as well because Flora Harvey, who was actually the stage designer for the stage, I sent her the input map from Resolume, and then she sketched those out in Procreate. And just by using, you know, three different versions from those, I created this kind of sketch animation, and this looked really sick as well. Yeah, so these were kind of different stage layouts and stage looks, which I just mixed in and used as overlays, and then worked from there. Then I also obviously worked with some regular content. And so what was the workflow then? So as you can see here, this fits, you know, the input map exactly. And then from there, it was split onto six projectors. Two of them were always stacked, so they were making the same output. So in the end, it was three outputs in total. The left wing, which were the containers to the left, the center, and the right. So each of these was one individual output. As you can see here, the left are all of these slices, and this is the input mapping, and if I go to the output transformation, this is what the final output of them looked like. And then we had the right side, which was basically the same thing. And, you know, this is just about actually sitting there and warping each edge to match the actual shape of the, you know, real world stage design. So left, right, and then here we have the center. And this one was tricky because the projectors were rotated by 90 degrees. So what I did for those is actually, let me just see if I still have this in here. Yeah, so I had one slice, which just is the entire image. And for the mapping, I rotated this by 90 degrees just to be straight. And we, in the E2, so in the video processor, we rotated the whole thing as well, just so it wouldn't be like super complex to always think, you know, like moving left is actually moving down, and you would always, you know, think everything in 90 degree angles. So what we ended up doing is first rotating it all by 90 degrees, then mapping it, and then just transforming it back into the actual scaling, so we wouldn't lose any resolution by doing that. And this was a very effective method to do this. And this is what it looked like. So this was a 4K output, and the sides were full HD outputs. What I also had was working with Chris, the LD, we actually also connected the X4 bars. So, you know, these LED bars that were in between the shipping containers. And this way I could control them from my content, which would also give some amazing looks, because then you control everything from one single output, which is great. So to do that, you can see here that it's just a bunch of Lumaverses. He sketched down the DMX addresses for me to input here. You can see that here we always have these grids or these lines of the bars. And I would send the DMX signal to his MA3, which would then output it to the bars. So, you know, during the show, we could always say, now let's switch to my input, and then I could control the whole setup basically just from the video, which was neat. I think that pretty much sums up the output settings. What was neat about using individual slices for all of the elements was that you can then also use effects such as the slice transform in Resolume. So another neat technique that I used, there is a plugin in the Juice Bar, so kind of the, you know, plugin store of Resolume, called the Slice Tracer. So if you look for this here, there's this plugin, the Slice Tracer, which allows you to create some traces of your slices. You know, not just create some still outlines, but actually trace them. I installed this because I wanted to test it for these purposes. And so the problem here was that, again, it was just too many slices for it to function in a seamlessly. It works like this if you just have the outlines, but if you disable the merge function, well, actually this is surprising. It's running perfectly on my MacBook. It didn't on the media server on location though. So this is interesting. There's a big performance difference here from Mac to Windows, I guess. Anyway, this slice tracer is a kind of neat effect to create some outlines and traces of the slice. So again, here, if I have my length and the offset, so if I change my length to something like this and then the offset, I can animate it by clicking the symbol here and going to timeline. And so this is also a super quick and neat way to create some mapping effects. And I could create another layer and have an inner offset here. Increase the width maybe. And you can already see this is getting kind of interesting like that. But what I ended up doing, again, because on the media server on location, the performance wasn't enough to run this smoothly. So what I just did is, without animating it, just have some still frames of this and just creating a bunch of different layers with different offsets. So just having inner offset like this and like this, and then either changing the length to like full and decreasing the width to maybe like 5 or something, and then create another inner offset. And so you can already see this is kind of getting this interesting kind of digital pattern, I guess, or something like that. And so this was also something that I then recorded and then used as a mask. I mean, it doesn't really get any quicker than that to create some quick masks and outlines. If you compare it to, going into cinema, recreating the whole stage, this is just some super simple and very effective techniques to generate some quick, interesting shapes that interact with, the object that you're projecting onto, because that's what the mapping is all about. It's always this interaction between the object that you're actually projecting on and your content. What was also a fun one is using slice delay. So if I'm just using some regular content, a quick way to kind of adapt it to the shape is using the slice delay. If I go into my slice delay effect down here and drag all of my slices into the slice delay. And so now you can see that, well, maybe this actually isn't the best clip to test it on because it's too abstract. If I drag the same effect onto my camera, you can see that this also creates some fun patterns to work with. And, just even if I just start scaling around the image, this is creating some like real complexity very quickly, just because I mapped out all of the individual slices and can now mess around with that. And then of course you also have, you know, the Chaser plugin where you can create some quick chases, like randomly having individual slices appear, disappear, which I definitely used a lot, and then just having some bumps of the individual objects. And yeah, I think that's it for some of the techniques that I used for this one. If you have any questions, you can leave them in the comments, and let's also have a look at some of the results.